Hello everyone, and welcome again to Nettle, the best platform around for distance learning in business, finance, economics, and much, much more. My name is Sava, and today we are continuing our discussion of various ways to model stock return distributions and different theoretical distribution functions that might fit the empirical distribution function the best. Today, we are covering the Cauchy distribution, the function that is well known for generating one of the fattest tails, one of the highest likelihood of extreme events occurring, that is possible with relatively simple mathematical tools and concepts. So without further ado, we are still figuring out what distribution function is the best to model the returns of S&P 500. And today we'll try to calibrate the Cauchy distribution on our data. And we already have the daily returns calculated, we have them ranked, and we have already calculated the empirical distribution function as well as the theoretical normal distribution that would correspond to a distribution with the same mean and standard deviation. But obviously, whether the mean and the standard deviation even makes sense at all is dependent on what our beliefs are about the theoretical context of what law, what mathematical pattern do returns generally follow. And the Cauchy distribution is one of the clearest cases where mean and standard deviation or variance are actually not meaningful at all. If you look at the theoretical form of the Cauchy distribution, we can recognize something very familiar, the arctangent function. And arctangent function is a bounded function that is again between minus pi over 2 and pi over 2, that logic has been utilized previously in our hypersecond distribution function. But if we compare the two, we see that in the argument of the arctangent function for the hyperbolic second distribution, we have the exponent of some linear combination of x and the distribution parameters. In case of the Cauchy distribution, actually, we do not have the exponent of x. What will it do to the pattern, to the tails, to the character of the whole distribution is that we will have much higher likelihood of extreme events occurring. And as we have no exponent over here, the argument of the function is actually not bound by zero at the bottom. Theoretically, it can fluctuate between minus infinity and plus infinity. So to capture that, we actually need to add a half over here and multiply by 1 over pi instead of 2 over pi so that we still have something that is mathematically similar to a distribution function that needs to be bound between 0 and 1 so that it can be actually interpreted as a probability. Well, here in the Cauchy distribution we have two parameters, mu and gamma. And one might be, again, tempted to treat them analogously to just sample mean and standard deviation. But beware, in case of the Cauchy distribution, because of this very chaotic behavior of this function at the tails, we actually can prove, and it has been proven, that the mean and the variance of this distribution, as well as higher moments, for example, skewness, kurtosis, and even higher so, are either infinite or undefined. What it means is that the extreme events are so potent in shaping the whole distribution of returns that talking about some theoretical mean or some theoretical variance doesn't actually make any sense. Well, how then can we calibrate a Cauchy distribution based on data? Well, we could resort to the maximum likelihood estimation technique, but in case of the Cauchy distribution, it's very computationally difficult, and we can't use the method of moments because, well, the moments are either infinite or undefined. So we should resort to some compromise, some trade-off, some middle ground between the two. So a very common technique that is used to estimate those values mu and gamma for the Cauchy distribution is the following. First of all, you estimate mu as the sample median, not the sample mean, so exactly like we did with the Laplace distribution. And for gamma, we use the half of the interquartile range of our distribution. So the interquartile range is something that can be very easily computed using the empirical distribution of returns, or any data in particular. So the interquartile range is the difference between the third quartile and the first quartile. The quartiles are the frequencies in the distribution that split the data evenly into four equal chunks. So the third quartile will be the 75th percentile. So the value, 75% of occurrences, of which is equal to or lower than this quartile. And the first quartile will be the 25th percentile. So the value of the function that would be, so the value of x that would correspond to 25% of all potential values of x being equal to or less than this first quartile. To figure those out from our empirical distribution, we can apply the percentile function in Excel and select the exclusive percentile from the two functions available in Excel, and just select the whole array of returns and type in the percentile that we need to extract. In this case, it would be the 75th percentile, the third quartile. Quartile, again, is just a term to signify four, so quarterly, that's where this term also appears, equal chunks of data. So third quartile is the 75th percentile. So the 75th percentile is 0.46%. It's higher than the median, median being the second quartile by definition, or the 50th percentile. And the 25th percentile, the first quartile, would be exactly the same, but we'll just select a different threshold. So they select the area of returns and put 25% over here. And we see that the first quartile is minus 0.29%, which is again lower than the median, being the second quartile or the 50th percentile, naturally. So now here we need to estimate our gamma, which would be the half of the interquartile range. So the half of the difference between the 75th percentile and the 25th percentile. So 75th percentile minus the 25th percentile divided by 2. And we see that our gamma is equal to 0.38%. Now we know all of the parameters and we can estimate the Cauchy distribution function for our set of data. So over here, we can just type in, first of all, 1 divided by pi. And again, to get pi in Excel, we need to specify it as a function. So just put empty parentheses after you have written pi, and multiplied by the arctangent function, so a tan, of the return, so the observation, minus mu, so in this case, that's our sample median, and we lock the row over here, as it doesn't change as we simulated for different observations, and divided by gamma, so that is the scale variable of our distribution function, and that's half of the interquartile range that we've just computed. And again, we lock the row here as well. And then, as we haven't bounded our argument of the arctangent function from below, it's from minus infinity to plus infinity, at least theoretically, we need to add 1/2 after that so that our Cauchy distribution function is bound between 0 and 1. Enforce this formula and bottom right click it all the way down, and we can already see how fat of a tail a Cauchy distribution gives us. Here, we see that for the empirical distribution function, the returns that are equal to or less than minus 4.1%, bear in mind that's a very substantial loss a benchmark makes in a single day, the normal distribution gives it roughly 0% chance of occurring, while actually it happens around 0.08% of the time. The Cauchy distribution says that at almost in 3% of all cases, the return will actually be smaller, so the loss will be greater than minus 4.1%, or equal to that. So we can already see how fat of a tail the Cauchy distribution is capable of generating. And on the right tail, that's exactly the same. We see that the Cauchy distribution gives us 2.45% of a chance for the one-day return exceeding 4.96%, which again shows us how the Cauchy distribution is capable of modeling some of the very extreme behaviors that can be shown and or that can be manifested in return generating processes of some of the least liquid financial instruments or some of the most risky ones, such as small stocks, illiquid stocks, benchmarks of emerging markets, or something like cryptocurrencies even. So if we look at the Cauchy distribution function graphically, we'll see how fat of a tail it generates. It fits the data extremely well around the median, but then it diverges significantly. So the gray line that represents the Cauchy cumulative distribution function actually parts ways with the empirical distribution function and has a much fatter tail. So this distance between one and the graph is much higher for the Cauchy distribution than it is for the empirical distribution function. And the normal distribution obviously is left somewhere far, far behind because the magnitudes of extreme events that is generated by the Cauchy distribution is way, way ahead of the ones that the simple normal distribution is capable of showing. So what is the bottom line? We have learned what the Cauchy distribution is and how it utilizes the same mathematical concept of the arctangent function to come up at a different magnitude of extremity than the hyperbolic second distribution that we investigated earlier. And we can see that this distribution actually is way more extreme than real world financial markets. So is Cauchy distribution useful in modeling stock returns or financial markets? Yes, but not entirely applicable to some of the well-developed and not as chaotic distributions like S&P 500, but it's very much applicable to something like cryptocurrencies or alternative investments. And I urge you to try it for yourself. Please leave a like on this video if you found it helpful. In the comments below, please suggest any further topics in business economics or finance you would like me to cover in future videos. And don't forget to subscribe to our channel. Thank you very much and stay tuned.